We're actually in the sixth week of our study on the book of Acts, and we're going to be in Acts chapter 5. Now, by Acts chapter 5, the new church is beginning to gain a little bit of steam. They have a very effective healing ministry, and they're teaching and they're preaching, and the text says that many men and women were coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ and were becoming involved in the Jesus movement. Now, this was great for the church, but it unfortunately was not so good for the established religious groups that were already there. And so let's hear what happens as the story continues in Acts chapter 5, verse 17 and following. Then the high priest took action. He and all who were with him, that is the sect of the Sadducees, being filled with jealousy, arrested the apostles and put them in public prison. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors, brought them out, and said, "Go stand in the temple and tell the people the whole message about this life, that is, the life of Jesus." And when they heard this, they entered the temple at daybreak, and they went on with their teaching. Now, when the high priest and those with him arrived, they called together the council and the whole body of the elders of Israel, and they sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the temple police went there, they did not find them in prison. Then skip ahead to 25. Then someone arrived and announced, "Look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and are teaching the people." And then the captain went to the temple police and brought them, but without violence, for they were afraid of being stoned by the people. Now, when they had brought them, they had them stand before the council. And the high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name, and yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him in his right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things." And when they heard this, they were enraged. They wanted to kill him. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, respected by all people, stood up, and he ordered the men to be put outside for a short time. And then he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, consider carefully what you propose to do to these men. For some time ago, Thunius rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men joined him, but he was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and disappeared. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up at that time of the census and got people to follow him. He also perished, and all who followed him were scattered. And so in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. Because if this plan or this undertaking is of human origin, it will fail. But if it's of God, you won't be able to overthrow them. In that case, you may be even found to be fighting against God." And they were convinced by him. And when they had called in the apostles, they had them flogged. And then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus, and they let them go. And as they left the council, they rejoiced that they were considered worthy to suffer dishonor for the sake of the name, that is, the name of Jesus. And every day in the temple and at home, they did not cease to teach and to proclaim Jesus as the Messiah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, so in a small town, the Methodists and the Baptists and the Presbyterian pastors all got together, and they decided to save a few bucks, and they hired one evangelist to go and to preach at each of their churches, one in a row, you know, this church and this church and then this church. And so after all the revivals were done, the pastors all got together to talk about how things went. The Methodist minister was just absolutely gushing about the whole thing. He said the revival worked out wonderfully for us. He said, we got four new families. And the Baptist pastor, well, he was equally as enthused. Well, we did even better than that, he said. He said, we gained six new families out of the revival. All eyes next were on the Presbyterian pastor. Well, he said, we did even better than that. He said, we got rid of 10 of our troublemakers. Presbyterians have always had more than our fair share of troublemakers, if the truth be told. We always seem to be upsetting the apple cart. Did you know, for instance, that at the time of the American Revolution, 75% of the colonists were Calvinists? True. And 50% of the soldiers, one half of the soldiers in Washington's army, were Presbyterians. When the war ended, in fact, all but one of the colonels of the Continental Army were Presbyterian elders. And as I hope you learned when you turned and greeted your neighbor, John Witherspoon was the only minister to sign the Declaration of Independence, and he was, you guessed it, a Presbyterian. Yes, he was. The role of Presbyterians in the American Revolution was so great, in fact, that German historian Leopold von Ranke concluded that, quote, John Calvin was the virtual founder of America. Well, that may be overstating it a little bit, but the influence of Calvin and Calvinism and the Presbyterian Church is undisputed. Another historian, Sherwood Work, for instance, said, the kind of people that John Calvin produced made the American experience possible. Wow! Presbyterians, in fact, were so involved in the American Revolution that in many parts of England, the war was simply called the Presbyterian Revolt. Presbyterians have, as a general rule, been troublemakers. They've been revolutionaries who have worked to spread God's kingdom even when that kingdom was countercultural and upset the religious and the political status quo of the day. And they still are. So on this Independence Day weekend, let me ask you this. Are you a revolutionary for God's kingdom? Or are you more of a status quo kind of person? Our scripture passage this morning is a case study in these two ways of being Christian. On the one hand, we have the Sanhedrin, the ruling body of Israel, comprised of the high priests, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees. These are the official religious power brokers of the day. Their job was to keep their own people from causing too much trouble for the Roman occupation forces. They were in power and they wanted to stay in power. These are the folks who conspired, by the way, with the Roman government to kill Jesus when he started to undermine their teaching and their authority. And now that Jesus' followers are following in his footsteps, the Sanhedrin is reacting to them in much the same way as they did to Jesus, with jealousy, threats, anger, and torture. Note, the flogging is a terrible torture. They did anything to stay in power. Their chief spokesperson is the Rabbi Gamaliel. And while in some respects he is to be admired for his level-headed statesmanship, he's also to be pitied because he represents the status quo mentality that a gentleman by the name of Phil Edwards calls the Legion of the Unjazzed. The Legion of the Unjazzed. Now you may ask, who in the world is Phil Edwards? Is Phil Edwards a theologian? Is he a philosopher? Is he a pastor, a politician, or a guru? Who is this guy? No, Phil Edwards is none of those things. Phil Edwards is a world-class surfer who travels around the world entering surfing contests and writing about his experiences. Says Edwards, quote, there is a need in all of us for a controlled danger. There is a need for an activity that puts life. There are uncounted millions of people who are going through life without any sort of a real vibrant kick. I call them the Legion of Unjazzed. Mayor, although he would probably deny it, states perfectly the philosophy of the legions of the unjazzed in his response to the apostles and the early church. His argument goes like this. He says, if this Jesus movement is of God, of human origin, it will fail and we don't need to do anything. If, on the other hand, he says, it's of divine origin, there is nothing that we can do to stop it. Therefore, and this is inevitably the counsel of the legion of the unjazzed, we don't need to do anything. Now, although there certainly are times in life in which it is prudent to wait and to see, wait and see as an overarching life philosophy definitely leaves something to be desired. Thank goodness our Presbyterian forefathers and mothers didn't wait and see which side was going to win in the American Revolution before getting involved. Thank goodness they didn't sit on fences, or else we would all still be sitting at home eating scones and having high tea this Wednesday, no doubt. No. Like Peter and the other apostles in Acts chapter 5, they realized that the kingdom of God and the kingdom of man, woman, are often in conflict, and that there comes a time in which we have to decide which we are going to obey. And so they made a decision. A decision, in the words of Peter, to, quote, obey God rather than any human authority. A decision that cost them dearly in terms of harassment, threats, and even torture that flogging. And dear friends, I would put it to you today that there is still a decision for you and I to make. And it too is a decision about whether we're going to obey God or human authority. For the gospel of Jesus Christ is every bit as revolutionary, every bit as countercultural, every bit as challenging to the norms and values of our society as it was to the Apostle Peter's society. Hear the Sanhedrin's command to Peter and to the disciples after they were flogged. What was it? Stop speaking in the name of Jesus. Stop that, would you please? And what increasingly is the message of our society to the church? It's the same. Stop speaking in the name of Jesus. We are offended, some say, by your religious particularity. How dare you tell us that all religions aren't exactly the same? How dare you tell me that you have had an encounter with truth? What is the truth? There's no such thing as truth anymore, our society says. It's just my way of seeing things versus your way of seeing things. It's all relative, so would you please, please, just stop speaking in the name of Jesus. Others say that they are offended by the church's ethics. Why do you keep harping on this justice thing, some people tell us? Why do you keep pointing out to us that the gap between the haves and the have-nots in our culture has been growing steadily over the past 30 years? In 2011, for instance, the 400 wealthiest Americans had more wealth than half of the Americans combined. Let me just say that again. In 2011, the 400 wealthiest Americans had more wealth than one half of our country combined. And dear friends, it has only gotten worse. And by the way, lest any of you start finger pointing saying, oh, it's so-and-so's, this party's wealth, or this party's wealth, let me remind you that in the past 30 years, we have had 16 years under Democratic presidents and 14 years under Republican presidents. This is not a partisan issue. And some of you at this point may well be telling me, you want me to stop speaking in the name of Jesus because you're getting a little squeamish, aren't you? I am. It's a messed up world that we're living in, friends. A world that is alienated from God and the values of God's kingdom. Values like respect for all people, including those that you disagree with, including your behavior on Facebook. Honesty, humility, meekness, righteousness, mercy, compassion, hospitality, purity, justice, and peace, as Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount and in many other places. A world with many rights but few responsibilities. A world of the individual is everything, with little concern for the community. A world so divided that the lowest common denominator of ethics has become just embarrassingly low. A world where some, even some who profess to be Christian, will still throw Jesus and Jesus' words under the bus in order to maintain political power. And the church of Jesus Christ today is being hard-pressed on all sides, the left and the right, to accommodate to this lowest common denominator culture. And I put it to you, there is a decision to be made, to obey God or to obey human authority. Greater the legion of the unjazzed who choose to obey human authority and sit on the fence. And pitiable are they also, for their happiness is fleeting, their hope is momentary, their strength is illusory. But blessed are those who obey and walk in God's countercultural ways. As the Apostle Paul says, though they are afflicted, they are not crushed. Though they are perplexed, they are not driven to despair. Though they are persecuted, they are not forsaken. Though they are struck down, they are not destroyed. Though in Christ, they are free in Jesus Christ. Like the early church, we too must obey God rather than any human authority. We must place God's values above all other human authorities, above political concerns, above national concerns, above personal concerns. Either Christ is the Lord of all, or He is not the Lord at all. Thank God that our ancestors understood this. How about you? How about me? Are we willing to be revolutionaries for Jesus? Or are we going to cling to the status quo at all costs? Choice is ours. To pamper ourselves into mediocrity or to lose ourselves into eternity. And God grant us, Holy Spirit, that we, in decisions both small and large, might choose courageous. Gracious God, we want you and we want the world. We want it all. We can't have it all. And Lord, we need to make you the Lord of all of our lives, of our thinking politically, of our thinking about our nation, of our thinking about the world, our thinking about our own lives, about our families. Lord, it's true. Either you're the Lord of all that stuff or you're not the Lord at all. Grant us courage, Lord, that we in the church might choose wisely, that we might be careful in our worldly alliances, that we might be faithful in our commitment to you and to your values in this world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing Lead on My Vision. Right. If you're able, please rise.